I'm essentially a researcher. I'm an economist by training. I spend 80% of my time doing research, and I spend the rest 20 doing this. I basically, I teach at the Indian School of Business. I teach game theory and social enterprise. And I also teach at the Ashoka Young India Fellow. I occasionally go and do some educating of government employees in different ministries. But yes, essentially I'm a researcher, and I'm going to talk about research, okay? So thank you for giving me this opportunity to talk to a handful of very young, bright minds. But I'm not going to. Basically, I started out, as she started introducing me, I said, what are the things which are not accurate? First, what I do is not accurate. Secondly, what I'm going to talk about is not just financial policy, okay? And the reason I'm not going to talk only about financial policy is because there is so much of interesting evaluation happening in broad public policy in India. You know, the government is a very large part of India, no? Indian economy. Government is a very large player in almost all the sectors. So we are going to talk, I'm briefly going to talk about financial inclusion, but I also want to talk about what's happening in the health policy space. I'll talk to you about what is happening in the gender inequality space. I'll talk about the education ministry. I'll talk to you about NAREGA. It's very important that you understand some of these big flagship programs of the government and the evaluation, the research that is coming out of it. Okay? But let me start out by saying that why should we be concerned with evaluation? Why does evaluation matter? How many of you are from the private sector? Raise your hands. Now obviously it's not just a set which includes private and public. There must be something else. How many of you are with the public sector? Okay. The rest of you are neither. If you understand business, you know that we almost never evaluate businesses, right? Do we ever say, let's evaluate Citigroup? Let's do an evaluation of ICICI Bank. Let's do an evaluation of a restaurant or a hotel. We don't do that. Why? Because the market doesn't. You cannot be running a bad business over a long period of time. You're going to be evaluated out of the market. That's why you don't evaluate businesses, private corporations. Okay? But that's exactly the reason why we must evaluate government. Because government evaluation is not done by the market. Government programs and designs are done by people like us, who think that we should have NAREGA, we should have insurance for health, we should have roads built here and bridges built there. It is not market driven. Do you understand? So evaluating government scheme is a very fundamental component to public policy. We must know whether that scheme, that program is making sense. Does it have an impact? And at what cost? Okay? So evaluating the government becomes absolutely mandatory. In fact, almost all government schemes that we have outlays set aside for, there is a certain fraction which is put aside for evaluation. We say that we'll put 100 crores for this program, but out of that, 5 crores will go into evaluating how the scheme is doing. So there is a recognition internally within the government that we need to put aside money for evaluation. Evaluation also costs money, but we need to fund it. But there lies the problem. Well, first of all, this whole idea of evaluating government program is also a new idea, and it is completely missing in capacity. We have very few people, we have very few technical expertise that can really do this. Okay, so we can put the money aside, but most of that money is sitting idle. Alright, so evaluating the schemes become absolutely important. Now the reason I say this is a new idea is because, you know, the World Bank, the UN, they've been spending billions and billions of dollars on different kinds of development schemes for a very long time without really knowing what the impact is. So there's been a huge pushback from researchers globally, and more than researchers, local people saying, you know what, this dam is causing problems. This road is not worth it. There's been so much of backlash against development spending, not just spending, but the way it is spent. that evaluation has now become an integral part of all development policies. That's why evaluation is necessary. And this is where I'm going to basically talk to you about different sectors of the Indian government and tell you about what's happening in the evaluation space. And most of these schemes you have heard of, I presume, because you read newspapers, okay? It's basically a functioning and a mentality that evaluation challenges. Have you heard of Milton Friedman? Okay. What did Milton Friedman say very famously? He said, you know, when a private business fails, then it is moved out of the market. When government program fails, what is the general tendency? We are not putting enough money. Let's put more money there. Now, do you see the difference in the mentality? It's a very simple but a fundamental and an entrenched mindset which we have to shape. Maybe some schemes are doing well, in which case we should fund it more. We should redesign schemes because there is a problem midway. There is something we have not foreseen. Remember, public policy is not a pure science. It's not physics. It's not chemistry. It's definitely not mathematics. It is involving human behavior, which means there are lots of unforeseen, unaccounted for factors which are going to come into play. Even if you've done a fantastic model, which is what we try to do in economics, we try to account for as many things as you can, but still there'll always be certain things which will change. When those other things changes, how should the scheme be changed, be altered, be redesigned? That's the fundamental reason why we need evaluation. And let me start out by motivating NREGA, okay, which is now called the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. Okay, it's an act because the parliament basically mandates, it's an act by which all rural households in India, they are entitled to 100 days of unskilled minimum wage employment within 5 km radius of where they live, and they get the job, they should get the job within 2 weeks of applying for it. Now, those of you who have ever managed anything will know what a tall order it is on the government. Because the government is not Delhi. The government is that block development officer sitting there who has to generate thousands and thousands of jobs within certain location, within demand coming 2 weeks, you have to keep generating jobs. It's a very tall order. You're also expecting a lot from the government and these individuals in this capacity. Job creation is not easy. And that too, when you have a very strict rule on how to use the money. 60% has to go in terms of unskilled wage, 40% can be used as material. So now, given your constraints, imagine, put yourself in that position. It's not easy. Okay? So let me tell you now, what do the evaluations of NREGA tell us? Well, first of all, there is a minimum wage in this, right? Because you will get employed for 100 days at a minimum wage. Now, this is where the politics comes in. Minimum wage varies by the state. States set up their own minimum wages. So then we started with doing an evaluation. Now, it is actually quite serendipitous because we didn't start out by doing a study for NREGA. My original study, which again got picked up, of course, it's a well-published, well-cited, but also got picked up by the parliament in 2009. And since then, we've been talking at various forums with different governments, different state and central governments about the scheme. But at that point, my study was basically trying to evaluate a new program of the World Bank, which is being replicated in 8 different countries. What is the idea of that program? It was mostly motivated by microfinance. And I'll talk about microfinance in a minute. But the idea of that original study is that, you know, microfinance is for people who have some economic activity, correct? Because it's a loan, you have to pay it off. So you have to have some activity in which you can use the loan. But there is a very large proportion of the Indian population which lies below that economically active poor. They're destitute, okay? They are ultra poor. And there is a certain definition for ultra poor. That policy or that particular development project of the World Bank, which was replicated in 8 different countries, and India was the largest, and we evaluated it. That's why this study became such a massive study. We did this in Medak district, one of the poorest districts, now in Telangana, then in undivided Andhra, The study started in 2006. What is the idea? That when you have very poor people, you can't give them a loan. What will they do with a loan? So you do a transfer. You give them an asset. You don't decide what asset to give them because that is too top down. They are given a menu. That menu involves the kind of local activities people in the neighborhood do. Rearing livestock, okay, chicken booth, having a telephone booth, having a tailor shop, a small horticulture. So there was a menu of 10 different activities which can be done within the budget that we have at the per capita level. And you are given a menu. So that ultra poor household says, I'm going to choose this. Then they get training in how to manage that asset. Then we buy the asset, we transfer it to them, insure the asset, and we do some hand holding for 18 months. Now do you understand the idea of the project? It is basically trying to transform ultra poor, very poor households into micro entrepreneurs so that they begin to take care of this asset which has a cash flow. Most people chose livestock, buffalo. Okay? Buffaloes, why? Because buffaloes have a regular cash flow for almost 8 months of the year. You tie them with the milk scheme. We taught people how do you measure the fat content in the milk so you can negotiate the price. We tied them with the fodder scheme because the government has its own fodder scheme. And once you've set up the entire logistic, for 18 months we do hand-holding, meaning this is how much money you earn, this is what you should do, this is how much you should try to save. 18 months of very rigorous, very close, costly hand-holding exercise. After 18 months we say, okay, we do the first end-line evaluation. What happened to these guys? How are they compared to how they were in the beginning? But also this is a randomized control trial. How many of you have heard of RCT, randomized control trial? I'm very happy to see. It's probably 10% of the class, but that's large enough. 5 years back, that would have been even lesser. Randomized control trial is a technique of evaluation which we usually used to use only in medicine. Because in medicine, to see whether a medicine has an impact, you don't give it to people who come for it. You choose a group, a sample, you divide the sample randomly into half and half. To half the group, you give the medicine. To the other half, which is a control group, you give a placebo, sugar pill. But nobody knows what is what. And then you see what the impact is. This is a randomized control trial. Okay, it's randomly decided who gets the treatment and who doesn't. That's what now we have brought into social sciences, in economics, into development sciences. What we do is, this ultra poor experiment, we took up 300 villages in Medak district. We randomly chose 300 villages, 150 villages. In those villages, the ultra poor were selected for this treatment, given the menu, transfer, etc. The other 150 villages, ultra poor are chosen. We do the baseline survey, but they don't receive a treatment. 18 months later, we want to see how have these guys done vis-a-vis how they were in the beginning and compared to the control. That's the technique of randomized control trial. How does this link with NREG? I'm getting to it. In 18 months, when we went and did a follow-up, what do we find? That these ultra-poor households have more income, they are eating better, the children are more likely to stay in school. You also have anthropometric data, meaning you weigh the children, you take the height. Height and weight of children under 13 changes a lot with time. So it's a good measure of development. Okay? And after 18 months, basically we said, now you're on your own. Because there has to be some degree of sustainability. So we move out of these villages, people are left on their own, and then the experiment is still going on. 1 year later, we go back and do another end-line survey of the treatment and the control to see what is the long-term impact when we are not there watching and hand-holding them. What do we find? Zero difference. There is no difference between the treatment group which received this asset and training and the control group which didn't receive anything. Why? Because this experiment I told you about is like a lab setting where nothing else is changing. But in Andhra Pradesh, in all of India, what is happening around 2006? National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. It's one of those big movements that have happened in rural labor markets, okay, which led to real wage increase of 38% in Andhra Pradesh. That has never happened in the history of rural India. that kind of a phenomenal increase in real, I'm not talking about nominal, okay, so accounting for inflation, real wages are for, you know, undergoing massive increase. So now my treatment households are thinking, I could do that and earn much more than be stuck with a buffalo. Now the opportunity cost of taking care of these small enterprises is increasing. Earlier, I would give up, most of them were casual laborers to begin with, that's what ultra poor profile is usually. Earlier, I'm giving up casual labor to take care of my assets, small enterprise or buffalo. Now, if I remain casual labor, my wages would have been rising at this level. So the real cost of taking care of an enterprise or a buffalo is rising because you're accounting for opportunity foregone. It's very important you understand the concept of opportunity cost. When you forego something good to manage something, you have to account for what you are foregoing, not just the accounting cost, okay? So what are households doing in the long run? More than half of them sold off the assets. They sold off the assets, went back to being casual labor, and in the meantime, the casual labor in the treatment are earning more and more wages. In net, what do you see? No difference. Okay? So now, simultaneously, we are doing many, many studies because we have a lot of data and we are following households, okay, on almost 6-monthly basis. First study we did showed that, you know, amongst the ultra poor villagers of Andhra Pradesh, I will try not to generalize for the rest of the country, okay, because Andhra is special in many ways. If it's okay with the format, I'm happy to take a question. Oh yeah, I'm happy, yes. Nobody knew how to take care of it after 18 months of training. Listen, it's taking care of buffalo, it's not writing software. Okay? So what happens is that hand holding that you're talking about, people learn very fast. The 18 months is what you're thinking about, you know, some degree of financial training. Basically watching that you are actually taking care of the buffalo, you're doing some basic meeting. So it's not that. People knew, because remember, even amongst the ones, half are selling but the other half are keeping. The ones who are keeping are growing, so it's not a complete failure. Now we are talking about a different thing. How do you identify entrepreneurs? People who can actually grow from one buffalo to four, because it's happening. But on an average, when you think about a development scheme and you're trying to say, does it work? It's a simple question, but you say yes it does or it doesn't based on averages. Then you take the average and look at the distribution. Some will do very well, some will do very badly. On an average, this is the impact. Okay, so it's not the impact of the trade, because they know what to do with it. Okay, what you have to realize is it NREGA directly which is messing up with the micro enterprise market because they have now raised the labor cost? No, it's casual rural labor market at large that is now witnessing a rise in wages. Private rural employees have to now pay, they have to match the government minimum wages in order to attract labor. That is what is leading to NREGA is having a multiplier effect in the rural labor markets. Okay, so all jobs which involve labor or casual labor is witnessing a rise in wages, which is very good if you are a casual laborer, but it is not so good if you are a small enterprise which hires labor, because your cost of running the enterprise is now undergoing significant rise. So now we are saying micro enterprise is not just people with buffaloes. Micro enterprise are people with small plots of land, small farmers, even medium farmers, because there are many of them, you know, did not harvest. Because the cost of harvesting because of labor was so high, they said, let it rot. We'll use it as fodder. Now, what I'm trying to sensitize you to this. First finding, what do we see? That people who went for NREGA versus people who got denied the job because of some reason. Remember, there is government capacity also to create jobs. So at the margin, people were getting turned away. Those who got the employment are eating better. So, consumption increase. What are measurements of consumption or food security? One is monthly per capita consumption expenditure on food. Okay, that's obvious. Second metric is, how many meals do you forego in a day? At the household level, meaning there was no cooking in the household. Second, at the individual level. Okay, how many meals did the individual forego in the last 1 week? These are different measures of food security. Okay, and when you look, the obvious impact is NREGA did lead to higher food security, better food security. But what is happening now, you have to move beyond the partial impact of the program on beneficiaries to looking at the economy, what it is happening. At the economy level, what we are seeing is, because the rural labor wages have increased, the cost of running enterprises in rural India have increased. Because of which, you basically have people shutting shop. You have people downsizing. And worse, people switching from labor to capital. Earlier, I would employ 2 people to do the harvest. Now, I will rent the thresher or that machine which will do the harvesting for me. Now, higher, more expensive labor also motivates the producers to go for substituting the technology. I will go for more capital intensive technology, which in the long run is again bad for the labor. And on an economic point of view, it is definitely very bad for us. Now, take it even further. What do we see broadly that is happening at the NSSO at the national level? For the first time in our history, we are seeing a fall in self-employment and a significant increase in casual labor. What is that telling you? That India's growth with NREGA, while it is definitely affecting the very poor in a good way because it is giving them more food in the short run, over the time we are seeing that it is distorting growth, okay, by making labor expensive, such that you are basically making growth more expensive. Remember, growth is not just reliance. Growth is not just for oil barons. Growth is for a milkman who can sell all the milk that he gets from his buffalo at the right price. That is growth. That there is more demand in the market, there's more sale in the market, that's growth. That was getting impeded. That is still getting impeded because labor has become very expensive. Okay? Broadly, what are we saying? Now, we are seeing a direct tussle between growth and redistribution. Because we are saying we are making government the employee of last resort through NREGA, unless we say that NREGA is leading to huge gains in productivity because now we are creating assets in the rural labor markets, meaning, or you know, broadly rural sector. If we create good roads, that is good for the economy. If we create water harvest, that's again good for the rural economy. If we are training this folks who are working in NREGA, that's good because they're getting some skill. But we are not doing any of those things. It is highly debatable that even the assets which are getting created by the NREGA are worth anything. That they're actually leading to rise in productivity. Rising productivity is growth because the pie increases. If all we are doing is cutting the pie differently, then it is a pure redistribution scheme. We are simply taking money and giving it to the poor. Okay? That's very costly in the long run if you don't grow. Do you understand? I'm trying to sensitize you to this growth equity debate. It's a tension on a day-to-day basis. Am I saying NREGS is bad? No. In a growing unequal economy like India, you need NREGS. It's a social protection scheme. Okay? Because that growth is not going to the rural area, so we have to take it. And we have to take it in the form of some social protection. But it should be redesigned differently. It should be designed in a way, and these are recommendations that I have been sending. Some parts of the ministry are very open to it. There is a lot of discussion happening. We are discussing this at the Niti Aayog. We are discussing this. We discussed this earlier under the Planning Commission. But the government is also like this multi-headed hydra. We'll see eventually what gets done. Okay? But what I want you to understand is that schemes can be redesigned. Suppose we said the NREGS is only going to be for the summer months when there is no private wage employment available. If jobs are available during the rest of the year, why should we distort the private labor market? We should set minimum wages. That is elementary. Otherwise, in a labor abundant economy like ours, when supply is so large, what happens to the price? It will fall. So if you have everybody who's willing to undercut and work for something less than what he's willing to work, your wages will fall. Do you see that? Excess supply of labor means wages will get suppressed down. That's why you need a minimum wage. So minimum wage is absolutely necessary. But let's not have a scheme which is running through the year. That distorts the market a lot. Let's have it in the summer months when people actually don't have employment. Then we should be providing employment by saying, you know what? This is what you need. Then it's a pure redistribution, and that's fine. At least it's not harming growth. Okay? Then, maybe we should think a little more about what kind of jobs people should do. How about teaching people how to, you know, certain kinds of skill? Let people get employed, but in the process also get skilled. Why should it be unskilled employment forever? Let's call it semi-skilled jobs. Tailoring is not that difficult. Bangladesh did it. If you go to Bangladesh and you talk to some of these large firms which are doing very well in the apparel business, textile business, what will they tell you? All we need is somebody with two eyes and two hands. And we can train. It's very easy. And look at the quality. Their exports in textile is multiple of ours. And this is not a very new phenomenon. It's not an old phenomenon. This has happened over the last 10-15 years. You need the right policy. You need to design something which can then impact. Let's also start skilling people a little bit through these schemes. Okay? Tailoring is one. Maybe certain kinds of processing, food processing, making a chart. No? The whole idea of seva, you know, many of our NGOs and microfinance institutions have experimented with a little bit of food processing. We can do that under NREG. But what am I saying? I'm saying there should be productivity gains. It shouldn't be limited to a redistrict. If there are some productivity gains, either from the economy perspective or from the individual perspective, which can get translated into them having higher employment opportunities in the future, that's great. That's the whole idea of skilling in any case. Link it up with Skill India. So you can do multiple things. Let's put a better scanner on what kind of assets should be created. Get good minds to design certain projects. Let it not be left to the Gram Panchayat and BDO to come up with what all kind of projects should be implemented under NREG. Let's think of projects which will actually raise the productivity of rural sector. Okay? Everything that feeds indirectly into productivity while it is also a trance. That's the kind of redesign we are talking about. Okay? Now, let me move beyond NREGA to certain kinds of evaluation in the financial inclusion space. Now with this particular government, and I'm very happy about it, financial inclusion has become a big mantra. Okay? For those of us who have been working in this area for the last 15 years, financial inclusion remained a CSR at best. Okay? We have a microfinance industry in India which actually thrived, but because regulators didn't want to deal with them, there was always an arm's length approach to microfinance, as a result of which we've had crazy growth. Growth without regulation can also get out of control. So how many of you are aware of what happened in Andhra Pradesh? Some of you. What happened in Andhra Pradesh, Hyderabad happens to be the microfinance capital of India. Many of our large microfinance institutions are headquartered in Hyderabad. A lot of experimentation started there. The idea of microfinance is small loans for small enterprises. Okay? But when many people, now I want you to think theory. When you have four different microfinance institutions, call them banks, if you have four lenders who are willing to lend to the same borrower, what will happen?
Over-indebtedness.
First of all, remember that borrower's capacity to use. Everybody has a loan appetite, by the way. If you and I go to a bank, they will do due diligence, they will see how much we earn, what are we going to do with the money. So in theory, we talk about loan getting used for a project, the project realizing a revenue, there's a cash flow, and then you start paying, right? That's how we think of loan. What happened in this sector of growth is, you know, the emails or messages you get, take a loan, take a loan, take a loan. That's what happened in microfinance as well, as it happened in the rest of the country. Loans were being pushed. More and more loans are getting pushed to the same set of people, as a result of which, four loans to the same person. Over-indebtedness leads to debt trap. That's the first problem. Because I have to pay four of them now. And since I've got the money, I'll do something with it, most likely. Now, people are not drunks. Let's not have a paternalistic view of development, huh? That, oh, if you give them free money, they will drink it. They will use it because there is pressure on cash, no? There is somebody in the house who's sick. There is a child who needs a uniform. There is some emergency. I might have to pay back somebody who might have lent to me earlier. So there are different kinds of pressures on cash in a household. And you give in to these pressures, but none of these are productive immediately. So when your creditors come to your doorstep and say, now pay me back, what are you going to do? You go to the money lender and take a loan at a higher interest, because these are informal lenders. You take a loan at a higher interest to now pay creditors who are cheaper. That's a debt trap. When you're paying a cheap loan through a more expensive loan. Because how do you get out of the more expensive loan now? So that's a debt trap, okay? The other problem is, four guys lending indiscriminately to the same set of borrowers will also mean that now these four will spend a lot of money on recovery, because there's no real project behind it, remember. So I'm not going to wait for the project to get realized. Microfinance, by the way, is an excellent innovation globally, and it has repayment rates of 98-99%, which is unheard of in commercial banking. Right? The best banks today will give you 92-93%. Here are small borrowers and small banks getting 98-99%. That's incredible. The problem is, to maintain my 99% recovery, if four of us are lending to the same borrowers, we will send somebody to collect this money. Somebody every day. We will name, shame, put pressure. These things, beyond the point, for this group of people who are poor, politically it is a suicide. Remember, because you are dealing with poor who are also the natural catchment area of politics. That's why any social enterprise which goes out to eradicate poverty, if you don't do it the right way, if there is going to be overheating in the business, politics catches up very fast. That's what happened in Andhra Pradesh. Basically, the government banned them. They said, don't pay these guys back. But imagine what that that does to a bank. You're suddenly sitting with, from 99% repayment, now you have 32. You're sitting with a large bad debt. And you have raised money from the market. Your capital is coming from the market, because microfinance institutions don't collect deposit. So their source of capital is outside. It's expensive. So now that's actually getting into another kind of problem. What am I saying? It has to be regulated. Regulation is very important. There has to be credit bureau, where if there is one person who has a loan, it should get reflected to all the other creditors. And then the other creditors should do some due diligence before extending loan. Otherwise, it's a huge moral hazard. If all I care about is lending and lending and lending, and then recovering, that is going to lead to problems. That's why we need good regulation. We need a regulator who will ensure that there is more information in the market, so creditors shouldn't overlend, borrowers shouldn't overborrow. And when there is a problem, we can actually deal with it in the right way, through legal recourse. By the way, what I just told you about Andhra Pradesh, the theory of it is exactly the same that happened in the financial crisis, the housing crisis in the US. Subprime market. Microfinance is subprime. It's not prime. It is below prime. It is poor household. Okay? So the idea is the same. You are giving money to people who don't really deserve that loan. They don't have the loan appetite. They don't have a project to back it. You're just pushing loan. That's bad. Okay? So this has been the idea of financial inclusion for the last 15, 20 years in India. And Andhra government has the largest microfinance scheme. It is called the self-help group, SHGs. Okay? Self-help group is when groups of women come together and take a loan and then repay collectively. This government has taken financial inclusion to an entirely different level. By first of all, defining it very narrowly. And I'll tell you why that's a problem in a minute. But in the short run, it's a good thing. Opening bank accounts is that first step towards doing many other things. So the PMJDY, the Jan Dhan Yojana that we have, it had been experimented with earlier. Okay? The RBI had mandated no frills account for everybody in Maharashtra, for everybody in certain catchment areas of certain banks. We have been experimenting with these kind of things. But because there was no political weight behind it, it never really went anywhere. This time it was like a private dream of the Prime Minister's. And once it was launched, the public sector banks just went out and opened all these accounts. Public sector banks. most PMJDY accounts are opened by public sector banks. Now, this is where you must ask a question. Why not the private sector bank? Any answers? Huh? Absolutely. These accounts maximum will have one transaction where you say, you know what, I give you the NREGA wage in the bank account, you go withdraw it. Now for a bank to maintain accounts like these, which basically have one transaction, no transaction, in the long run is expensive. So banks usually resist this. So the economics of it is such that the cost has to be borne by somebody. And in this case, we are basically saying, you know what, public sector banks also have a public mandate, so you can call from Delhi and then they will comply. The private sector banks have resisted it to some extent, but beyond the point, I think they should be involved in this process. Okay, I don't know whether they'll do it part of CSR, whether they will do it mandatorily, whether they will do it part of the priority sector lending. You know, priority sector is an important clause in the insurance and the banking business, which tells you 40% of your capital has to go to priority. What is priority? Rural, okay, small and medium enterprises, cottage enterprises, women, socially targeted group. So you can define what is priority, all right? But today, what does the PMJDY tell us? If you look at the government data and if you sit through some of these discussions, they will tell you that today, India has 100%, well, 99.9% financial inclusion. That's because everybody seems to have had opened a bank account. But then you must think that bank account is such a narrow and a simple instrument. Is it really financial inclusion? No. Financial inclusion is every other financial instrument that you and I would have access to. By the way, even you and I are living in a financially repressed economy. It's not true that you and I can suddenly go and start pension and provident fund and health insurance and life insurance. No, you can't do that. Because again, we are very, very repressive in our financial system. We're trying to open up. So for the below poverty line, it's even worse. They have access to a bank account, which they probably, they don't even know exists. They don't know what to do with it. So we are talking a lot about making that account active by either linking it to different schemes or by educating people, helping them deal with it in some way. Okay, either by linking it to some, you know, this overdraft facility that we have, it has certain insurance element to it. Educate people on how to use these facilities. Okay, so we have to push beyond just electronically opening bank account. So which means we have to incur some more costs. Yes.
Then why are we repeating this mistake of framing policies? Where, for example, like seeing from the Arshad Mehta policy, like, you know, he has used the loopholes in the policy. And the second thing, you are talking about the microfinance thing, what happened. And the next one is,
like the housing board, State Bank of Hyderabad housing board policy, which was into the crisis. And now Jan Dhan Yojana. See, we framed the policies, and after the policies are framed, we'll be knowing the loopholes of it, like maintaining the bank account. In Jan Dhan Yojana is the biggest loophole. Then why are we, you know, framing the policy still? Like, why are we not taking care of that thing?
Because we are humans. It's not pure science. Public policy is about trial and error. The point of people like me is that if you know that there is an error, then why are you trying it? So it's not pure science. Of course, we understand that policy making is a lot of learning by doing. But hey, if there is evidence from before that there is a problem, then why can't we just design something better? Now we get into the political economy of policy making. India, unfortunately, does not have the bandwidth capacity for research. Okay? And we have very little aptitude. And I'll tell you some of the numbers are mind-boggling. But we need it and we are going to push for it. Because there is no other way to form policy. It has to be driven by numbers, facts. Okay? It has to be driven not by experts sitting in Yojana Bhavan who think this is the way to do, but by actual numbers. Okay? So that is something which is still under trial and error. More ministries, and this is where you will see that entrepreneurial ministers will reach out and read reports and actually say, yes, why aren't we doing this? But you know, that also requires capacity. You're expecting ministers to now be entrepreneurial, and I would give it that ministers are far more entrepreneurial than the rest of the department. Now we are getting into administrative reforms. trying something new is expensive on the system. So we like status quo. Okay? That's why trying new things, you really need somebody sitting on the top saying, let's try this. Political entrepreneurship is something we must recognize. It's very important. Okay? And this is why Andhra Pradesh, I don't know if in when Mudit came and spoke to you, did he talk about his study, the OUP paper they have just published with Panagariya? The comparison of Andhra Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh. You know, Andhra Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh had the same level of poverty in 20 years back, 1993, AP had poverty of 48% and UP had poverty of 52%. What happened by 2003, in fact later on till 2008, you know what happened? Andhra Pradesh poverty level is 11% today, UP is 39%. Why? They started out the same. In 1993, if I was an industrialist and I had money and I wanted to set up an IT firm, I should have said, hey, UP has IIT BHU, IIT Kanpur, you know, it has all these other forms of universities which are creating, there is human resource. It has an IIM. What did Hyderabad, what did Andhra Pradesh have? Very few. Very, very few. At that point, any person who's seeing, whom should I hire, where is the human resource? Where should I go and set up my firm? They should have done UP, not AP. And yet, nobody went to UP, they all went to AP. Why? Good leadership. We discount it, we don't talk about it. But, Chandra Babu Naidu really did transform the nature of Andhra politics by being entrepreneurial. And it's not just him. You have to follow it up. Most of his entrepreneurial policies, which got these massive investments from outside, and not just money, Microsoft built its second largest campus outside of Seattle in Hyderabad. Okay, Infosys sets up a massive campus. ICICI has 25,000 people in a research center right in Gachibowli or around the same neighborhood. YSR continued those policies more aggressively. That's why you've had 20 years of unrelenting growth in Hyderabad, in Andhra Pradesh. They also recognize, because Chandra Babu lost the last election, that you can't have India shining only by looking at Andhra Pradesh. India also has to shine beyond the urban areas. That's why YSR learned from the mistakes of Naidu and raised the social investments much more. So the aggressive enforcement of NREGA, Arogya Shri, which is a standalone doing very well, a lot of corruption too, but nonetheless very aggressive pushing of health insurance. Huge social scheme, biometric card, even before we thought of UID, Andhra had its own smart card. We discount political leadership. We shouldn't do that. Because bureaucracy everywhere is the same. Very lethargic. It has to be driven. Bureaucracy or administration is a tool to be used. You cannot expect bureaucracy to be entrepreneurial. Okay? But leadership, political leadership is. And if it is entrepreneurial, look what it can achieve. In 20 years, you have lowered poverty from 48 to 11%. And not just urban, look at the breakup. Urban and rural poverty has fallen. You break it up, minorities, Hindus, SCST, fallen everywhere. It's like an all-encompassing growth and development. That's the kind of growth and development we need. And most of it didn't just come through large FDIs, huh? It also happened because we've had the largest number of new enterprises starting. Startups, there are so many. Hyderabad is a vibrant startup space. Why? Because there is a lot of incubation of new ideas. That's what growth is. Growth is about ordinary people with good ideas. You have the resource in terms of loans and the political support in terms of governance to really help you translate these ideas into business, which can then employ people and grow further. That's what real growth is. Growth is not about corporations. Growth is about ordinary individuals. Okay? That is what you have seen lacking in UP. UP had these old traditional institutions, centers of excellence of learning, but very little else to follow it up. Okay? So that's what we say in the PMJDY. We've had political leadership putting its entire force, weight behind it, and you've seen bank accounts opening. But now we need to take it further. It can't rest with bank account alone. Okay, Now beyond that, now it is going to go downhill. Huh? Now we are going to start talking about health. That is something that is personally, it really pains me. I think we have been so myopic in terms of health policy that it's almost shameful. India is one of those few countries where we have overwhelmingly started thinking of health in terms of financing and financing in terms of insurance. It's a very limited, myopic view of healthcare. It seems like we have learned nothing from the American experiment. America spends 18% of its GDP on healthcare. Singapore spends 4%. They both have very similar health outcomes. Okay, in terms of infant mortality, health capacity in terms of beds in hospitals, numbers of doctors, longevity, morbidity rates, very similar. One is spending 18%, the other is spending 4%. What is so different about these? While America overwhelmingly relies on health insurance, Singapore doesn't. In fact, Singapore's whole idea, Singapore is a city. So Indians tend to discount it by saying, ye kya hai? It's like Noida. Why should we look at that? China is looking at them. India is always very dismissive of anything, which makes sense, unfortunately. If China can experiment with it, and China, mind you, is as complex and larger, why can't we? You know what they've done? Their financing is mostly through medical savings account. You know what it means? It means people save for healthcare. Now, today if you go back and run any survey, and that's what I do for a living, all the surveys, if you try to understand the main motivation for people to save, you'll see more than 80% individuals will tell you that they save for healthcare. If there is an unforeseen circumstance, they would like to dip into their savings and be taken care of. Health is also the main reason why they're never able to match their health savings objective. Something always happens, so they have to draw down even before they reach that. What does that mean? That there's very little financial protection in healthcare. Singapore has been able to do it. What is the fundamental theoretical difference between health insurance and medical savings account? It is this. Insurance is fraught with market information asymmetry. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about economic theory, okay? Market information failure, such as if you are I'm a health insurance firm, I come into this room and I say, you know what? I'm selling health insurance, and given the age profile, the gender profile, and your backgrounds, I can say that this is the average morbidity rate based on which I have calculated a premium. So I come here and I say, here is health insurance. Who wants to buy it? Who will come and buy? People who feel they need it. There will be some degree of self-selection. People will come and buy if they think it is of value to them, otherwise they will not buy the health insurance. Now the folks who come and buy my health insurance policy are naturally going to be the ones who feel they have value. So they are sicker than the population. What does that do to my premium? Now my premium has to be adjusted, not to the group as a whole, but by the self-selected pool of people who have a higher morbidity rate. So my premium has to be raised. When I raise my premium, what happens? Amongst the group who have come to me, some of them who are a little healthy say, "Arey yaar, she's raised it even more, I'm not that sick. I don't need." What am I doing? The safer or the healthier amongst the group who came are going to get out of the market. Over time, morbidity rates of the self-selected people who choose health insurance keeps going up and up and up and up and up. So premium has to be adjusted higher and higher and higher and higher. This is a classic market failure. The insurer doesn't have complete information about the health of the buyers. This is market information asymmetry. If the buyer and the seller have different sets of information, market will not clear in an efficient way. So how do you overcome this? By mandating health insurance, that everybody has to have health insurance. That's what the US does. If I mandate, then there is no self-selection problem. Everybody is in the market and everybody buys insurance. So this is how you create market. But the problem is beyond that. The problem is not just what I just defined to you is called adverse selection. The problem beyond adverse selection is moral hazard. Today you go into a private hospital in India, they'll give you 20 checks to do diagnostics. You have gone with fever and they'll tell you check for diarrhea. and check maybe you have osteoporosis and check maybe you have a history of cardiac problems. We have all seen this. If you have insurance, there is always an emphasis on over-diagnosis. Why? And because I am insured, I'm like, yaar, theek hai, maybe they need all this information, I do want to get better. Because it's also not going out of my pocket. This is moral hazard. Moral hazard is when nobody is really monitoring because you're not paying for it. Do you understand? Moral hazard is when nobody has the incentive to check the cost. You overuse the facility. I will go to the hospital for small things. Earlier, if you know your child has diarrhea, you give ORS. Today, I will rush to the super speciality hospital. I'm insured. Insurance has serious moral hazard problem, which leads to cost escalation. If people are running and there's over-diagnosis and there's just over-medication, everything is making the system more and more costly. This is what the US system is today. And when the system becomes more and more costly, imagine the folks who are not insured. For them, one bad health shock and you are financially ruined. That is what health insurance is. Okay? Now, firms will counter the moral hazard by putting some deductibles, putting some co-payments that I will pay, but you should also pay some fraction of this. There is co-payment. You are aligning the incentive of the people who are sick or the buyers of health insurance to the firm. But you can't eradicate this. So when you have over-reliance on health insurance, it will lead to all kinds of market failures and cost escalations. That is what is happening in India today. Unfortunately, we are not yet thinking about new financial instruments like Singapore did. If it's a savings account, what happens? Alright, it's my health savings account. If I think these extra tests are unwarranted, I'll say, no, I'm sorry, I'm not going to do these. Because I'll have to pay for these. So there is an automatic control because my incentives are aligned. I don't want to overuse my savings account. What if I fall sick tomorrow? What if my children fall sick? So it's aligned with the incentives. Medical savings account is a much better health financial instrument than health insurance. But what have we done in India? We have not only gotten state-sponsored health insurance schemes, Arogya Shri, Vajpayee scheme, the Kalaignar in Tamil Nadu, but we have, since 2008, the RSBY, the Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana, which is like everybody under BPL has health insurance of a certain minimum amount. It's good. It's important to have these protections. But the viability of this in the long run is not there. Okay? Now, somebody should have asked me that with the savings account, what about poor who can't afford to save that much? Are you saying those of us who are well off, we can save and we'll get good treatment? Those who are poor, because they don't have enough income, they can't save much. So equity concerns become a huge problem in saving. That's when the government should step in. The government has to either match or fund the entire health bills, at least of primary OPD of the poor. Okay? That's we have to think about equity concerns when we are thinking of health. Yes. And I'll also ask, there was a hand there. Let's go to him first because he asked.
When we start with an insurance, the form says initial checkup of the person, but I don't see any of the health insurances doing it. So that will also lead to premiums being high because they initially don't check up and then the market, I mean, the way they have the selected group is either too sick or something, and so that distribution is there also, the distribution also gets wrong, right?
No, the theory would tell you that the health insurance firm has all the incentive to get you checked because if you have a health condition, I want to pick it up and your premium should be high, boss, right? The problem is, of course, it's the worst doctors who don't have better business, and I'm very sorry, but I'm going to be very candid. Who's doing this kind of checkup? What kind of doctors do health insurance checkup? Usually the ones who have a non-thriving consulting private business or government. So the non-practicing good doctors, there is a self-selection in that too, number one. Not to put a judgment there, but what I'm saying is that screening is also not of such a great quality. But even if it were of great quality, that's not my concern. My concern is, a 70-year-old who really needs health insurance will never get health insurance. That's what health insurance does. A health insurance firm will never insure the old. Why? Because they're going to use it. Look at the warpness of the instrument. That's why savings is the way we have to think of it. Insurance is good. I'm not saying it's a bad. We do need insurance. Because risks have to be pooled. And it's a good instrument. But it's not an instrument that you put all your eggs into that basket. That's what the US did. And look, 18% of GDP. And it's still a public policy nightmare. Why can't we learn from Singapore? Why don't we do health savings account? We put our money for pensions, right? We're putting money if you have jobs. All of us put aside money for provident funds. Why can't you put aside a little bit of that as medical savings? And for the poor, let the government pay for it. In any case, the government pays so much. Okay? That's one. That's the financing angle of it. Second is, what else is insurance doing? This over-diagnosis means that we are all rushing to the hospital for small ailments. What that does is, it completely makes your primary health and preventive health care defunct. More and more doctors, more and more patients, more and more money, public policy focus is going towards secondary and tertiary health care, hospitalization, super speciality. We are completely looking away from the general practitioner. Arey, when you have a fever or you have basic some diarrhea or something, a general practitioner should catch it. Our primary health care should be stronger. If your primary health care is stronger, you do early screening. Early screening is far cheaper and it's better for your health than make things so bad because you have to go into the hospital. And all our policy focus, unfortunately, is going towards the second. Okay, secondary and tertiary, super speciality. Our students are going towards super speciality. Today, find me one general practitioner. Our family doctors, they don't exist anymore. That's a shame. It's a crying shame. Why? Because we aren't that sick. So why don't we strengthen our primary health care? And preventive. Preventive means what? Little more social messaging on the tobacco, aerated drinks, clean India, Swachh Bharat, toilets, right? Chlorination of water. These are basic hygiene, nutrition. This is messaging which changes behavior, which impacts health directly. But these don't land you in hospital. They shouldn't. These should be early on caught. That's why we're saying preventive, and that's why, despite all the politics, I'm all for yoga. Why? Because yoga is seen as it's a preventive, it's a behavioral change to lifestyle. It makes you healthy. You should do it. Okay? We should put more money. In fact, 70% of our government resources in healthcare should go today in preventive and primary, not the other way around. Why do I say this? Because there was an experiment done. Again, a randomized control trial experiment done. When? People were given insurance for OPD. That if you have OPD needs and you go to a doctor, it will be covered. The minute people are getting incentivized to go to an OPD, the cost of hospitalization, the number of days in the hospital, and the cost to the system as a whole comes down to 1/4. That's a big change. That's a huge improvement. So let's put the weight behind basic screening, basic primary health care, preventive, not all curative. Curative is important, but where it should be needed. Let's not all go to super speciality because that's expensive. Okay? Now, let's also compare public policy spending, the government spending on healthcare. You know, as a country, how much do we spend on healthcare? Anyone? Okay, let me now get these two numbers. One said 4, the other said 1.2. As a GDP, we spend 1.2%. As a GDP. But as government spending, meaning of all the resources available with the government spends 4.1% of its resources on healthcare. How much does the Chinese government spend on healthcare? 11%. How much does the Thai government spend on healthcare? 14%. Why are we spending 4%? It's a question we must ask. And this is where we come back to public policy. We have to make these a priority. Having a large, sick population is not going to lead us to be smart in any way. So we can't have the first world economic aspirations and third world health infrastructure. They just cannot coexist. Okay, if anything, they are orthogonal. You have to have better healthcare facilities. Alright? And it's mostly in terms of design. Of course, we also have to put more resources into healthcare. Because, again, coming back to fundamental economic theory, you know, social enterprises are private businesses which have a market solution for a certain social problem, right? Healthcare, unfortunately, is not a very viable social enterprise. Okay? Maybe the super speciality or secondary, tertiary can be, not primary healthcare. Primary healthcare doesn't have margins. Do you understand what I'm saying? The profit margin is much more in secondary and tertiary. So if you have enterprises providing healthcare, they will all go towards secondary and tertiary. That's why today we might have the best private super speciality hospitals in all of SAARC region. We are a health superpower when it comes to super speciality hospitals. And it coexists with a terrible primary healthcare structure. Why? Because primary healthcare, you will not have businesses entering. The margins are so small. Business will not come. What does that mean? Market failures are there. Business not entering means markets don't function there. And if markets don't function, what are we making a case for? Government. It has to be public. Primary health has to be a government job. We have to improve the nature of our primary and preventive health care. Yeah.
To the general stereotypes, right? Where they're into primary, secondary and tertiary healthcare with high success rates.
If you make enough margins in your secondary and tertiary to then do CSR in primary, then you can do. But hey, how sustainable is that? CSR is good. I think more and more firms should put aside money for CSR. We'll get to that in a minute as well. But it's not viable. It's not a substitute for public investment. Because it's not sustainable. It's not generating enough to put investments into. Are you understanding what I'm saying? It's not sustainable business. There are no margins there. That means there is a market failure. If there is a market failure, what are we saying? Government. Government is the only way to do it. And if government is the way to do it, then let's put aside a good design, learn from the examples of the different countries. The UK has a very good healthcare system. Not everybody is happy, but on an average, they're much better. They spend half of what the US does. And look at their health outcomes, much, much better. Why? Because they have a very strong primary, government primary healthcare system. Okay? I think Jeff, you have a question.
Ma'am, apart from insurance, there are other backlogs in the health sector. Because it's also a demand pull sector as such. So if we keep the insurance sector aside, things like moonlighting and, you know, other problems where we don't question the doctor on why are we demanding, like why are they giving us a certain diagnosis, how do we account for these problems?
Well, the minute if it were your savings which is getting used, you are paying for it, you do ask. That's number one. But one thing which I forgot to tell you, the largest health burden rests still with the individual, because our out-of-pocket expenditure on healthcare is close to 70%, which means the health burden is largely borne by individuals. And you know what is the largest part of that health burden? OPD and drugs. People are not spending most on hospitalization. Our bills aggregate, if you look at NSSO morbidity data, or actually even if you look at the expenditure data, it will tell you that 3/4 of healthcare expenditure is on OPD. So that's where we should put the money, because that's where the burden is. We should put it on drugs, make more drugs generic, make many more drugs essential. Now, I'm by training a liberal market economist. Okay, so don't be suspicious. I'm very liberal. I teach in a business school. But as a good economist and as good thinkers, you must also recognize markets fail. That's where you go back to the theory. When the market fails, you need the government. And primary healthcare is one of those spaces where the market does fail, and that's where government investment has to be improved. Now, the kind of stuff she's talking about, yes, that is a cultural thing which will take time. When our teacher tells us something, it's got to be right, we don't question. When our doctors say something, we never question. That will change with more health literacy. That will change more with general literacy. Okay? And more awareness. With also, by the way, having second opinions. An evolved health market will mean digitized health records. If I do an OPD in Kanpur and tomorrow I don't get well and I'm sent to Delhi, then all my reports should hold, because there is some digitized central health MIS which is keeping record of all these things. I shouldn't come to Delhi and reinvent the wheel and shelve out another 50,000 only on diagnostics. Having a highly fragmented healthcare information system means huge loss of efficiency. Okay? But those things are, they will happen with time. First of all, we need to just recognize the need for primary health. Okay? And preventive health. All right. Otherwise it doesn't, that's it. Health savings means it's a labeled, it is only for health. Yeah.
Ma'am, for the past 20 days, we've kind of been hearing very similar stories. We need to invest more in healthcare, we need to invest more in agriculture, we also need to invest more in defense. And a lot of experts keep coming and telling us the same thing. We don't know where to raise this money, because if we have to raise more money, it's most probably going to come from individual taxpayers. That's one, right? Right, physical deficit that we'll have to work out. But essentially, nobody's talking about increasing efficiencies in the system.
You wanted to talk about it?
Please.
Okay. So there is something called the Expenditure Management Commission. Do you know about it? So Expenditure Management Commission was set up a year and a half back. And the whole idea of that commission is to come up with ways of making government spending more efficient. Expenditure has to be more efficient. I do sometimes go and advise this. So I know the kind of deliberation. And in my view, I think the best thing they have done is set the Expenditure Management Commission in the same building as the Pay Commission. Because a large part of managing expenditure is also managing, you know, administrative expenses. But, you know, our fiscal deficit, while it has to be cut down, we have to prioritize. Okay? And when someone tells you that you must raise more money into something, you have to see relative to what. Okay? I can be spending a huge amount on something, but if I do it inefficiently, raising money means nothing. Raising money will mean more inefficiency. So we have to, in fact, all our efforts right now as advisors to policy is not raising money in healthcare, yes, because we are so below the world, even developing standards, that we cannot ignore it. And I think the reason we ignore is the political economy of it. Those of us who discuss policy in healthcare, while we might be broadly affected if there is a dengue or there is something else, by and large the impact of this is not on the better off. Okay, so health is a great disparity where the better off can, you know, go to the best hospitals in the world today because they are in Gurgaon. And the rest can't. Other policies are a bit different. Defense and all is a little more, it's a bit more philosophical. Because then how much spending is too much spending on defense? How much spending is sufficient? Those become a matter of debate. Okay, it's not an optimization to be solved. But what we can definitely debate through numbers is how to spend this in the most efficient way. Alright? And that's the reason I'm talking about this financing scheme. Look at the beauty of the medical savings account. You don't have to raise money from the government. Isn't that what I'm telling you? That people will save for themselves because they're anyway saving for themselves. Just make it such that it gets linked to health. Right? So we don't have to do this kind of massive government-sponsored health insurance scheme. It will happen because people are saving it. We are just talking about changing the nature of these savings. By the way, if you've been hearing what the RBI governor has been saying over the last year, Indians save a lot. We are notorious, just like the Chinese, for having very high savings rate. But they do not get translated into investments. Why? Because they're not in forms that can be invested. We invest a lot in real estate, in gold. Gold, recently we've started to think of ways of bringing gold into the mainstream financial sector. So we're thinking of gold loans, we're thinking of different kinds of financial instruments around gold. But because we save, now we have to think of ways of bringing a lot of these savings into the mainstream financial sector that it can be. That's financial reforms. Yeah. Well, one of the reasons one of the reasons we have high savings in real estate is because of the black money problem. Okay, it's because of the nature of taxes and sometimes, you know, just the nature of governance in India and the corruption, which leads to such high levels of cash economy. Okay, you're right that at least the guy who's holding land or who's holding gold, they're unaffected by the financial crisis. But you know, that's like saying, let's not build roads because the invaders can use that road and invade us. That's, by the way, we're joking about it. But that is sometimes the reason given for our border roads not existing. That's ridiculous. No, we have to regulate it. But we have to bring more and more savings into the mainstream financial. It's not necessarily, it can be all kinds of instruments. It should be well regulated and well managed. That's what we are saying. Okay?
With such a disparity existing in income levels in the amongst the people of our country, how feasible is the medical savings model actually? And isn't a premium based on income model more feasible in the insurance sector actually? I just want your opinions on this.
The second, absolutely not. Are you saying that Anil Ambani, if he foregoes, and I'm very sorry to say these names, but these are just things that stick and that's why I'm... His heart attack is worth more than your and my heart attack. Premium cannot be linked to income. That is nonsense. Premium has to be linked to the cost. A business which is selling insurance will say, yeah, how much does it cost me to cover this kind of ailment? Not his or her. Financial instruments are agnostic of names. Do you understand what I'm saying? A smart instrument is one which takes into account the cost of doing the business and you put some margin to that. It cannot be that his insurance and his insurance are different because he's wearing blue shirt and he's wearing checked shirt. He's agnostic. Financial instruments have to be agnostic. If the premiums are different, it has to be that he's healthier than him because the cost is different. So not on income. Secondly, absolutely yes to government inequity being a problem. Yes, equity is a problem because if you have low income people and they can't save enough, then medical savings is not going to be enough. But then that is where we are saying that the government has to supplement it, either match it or completely cover BPL in any case, which we are doing. But it has to be savings, not insurance. They're different. Yeah.
So very interesting points and a lot of food for thought. But my main question is, how I see it is it's not just about BPL families not being able to save, but it's also mindset change, right? How are you going to incentivize people to save more and how are you going to bring this transition from insurance to medical savings? Are we going to make medical savings mandatory or are we going to have other incentives, and how is Singapore doing this?
So we do save more. We Indians save quite a bit. So just getting them to save more is not necessarily a challenge right now. It's about changing the nature of those savings. Okay? Now we are getting into the idea of, you know, black money, cash economy and all of those things. So there is a lot of thought going on right now into making electronic payments. We're trying to do away with cash. Okay, we are thinking about ways of, you know what, let's just get rid of the 1,000 rupee bill. We are trying to make transactions by making, you know, connectivity easier so that all kirana stores, all small places, large places have high connectivity so that it's all plastic. What are we doing? Of course, besides cash management is costly. Okay, so besides taking care of the cash management problem, we are also trying to tackle the black economy problem. We are trying to make more and more transactions white. So we are thinking of ways of doing that. Yeah. Oh, there's a hand at the back. She's had it on for a while. Yeah.
Ma'am, we need to realize that medical menaces exist now in the form of over-prescriptions or doctors suggesting surgeries like cesarean or angioplasty when it's not needed.
Absolutely.
And we can link it to, we can somewhere link the problems to insurance available. But you see, when you're seeing a transition from insurance to medical savings, how gradual are you, prescribing the change? Because as of now, nobody would want to, compromise or take risks when it comes to any medical emergency.
Hmm.
I mean, even if it's not needed.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you're in a crisis. I mean, you're going to go bankrupt if you don't have insurances.
Yeah.
So, how gradual are you prescribing the change?
So, this is a concern of, making the policy. It is not at the household level. Okay? But the money exists. People are covered. People have savings. It's really about starting a new instrument. That's it. Let me also tell you, sort of break the myth of insurance. The one big problem with insurance, as all our research has shown, particularly amongst microfinance clients are poorer than the average Indian household. Even when they are covered, they do not file claims. I don't say they never file claims. What I'm saying is the claims to coverage ratio is very low. Now, is this market segment healthier than the rest of the country? No. In fact, if anything, reason would tell you that they're probably unhealthier. Why are they not filing claims? They don't understand it. Insurance is not a simple financial instrument. It's a fairly nuanced. It's a sophisticated financial instrument which requires financial literacy, education, somebody telling you, you are covered. Especially if these insurance schemes are actually linked to other financial products such as loan. If you take a loan, you are covered and you're paying 1% additional interest as a premium, you probably don't even know that you are covered. Then, filing claims requires paperwork, requires you going and doing certain kinds of formal interactions. You don't have the ability. Okay? Insurance is not, it's had a huge problem with take-up. What I'm saying is instead of pushing insurance is one instrument. It's a needed instrument. Why is it needed? Because you want to pool your risks. Everybody will not fall sick at the same time. So you pool your risk, but it's not enough. You need to think of more creative ways to tackle healthcare costs. Okay, that's why savings are important. But remember, financing of healthcare is just one aspect of health policy. Access is one. Behavior is the other. Financing is only the third. When I say access, do you know that 80% of doctors, 75% of dispensaries, and 66% of hospitals are in urban India? Are you telling me rural India is healthier? They don't need it? No. It's telling you what the access is. The access is highly lopsided in favor of urban, but also if you look at the cross-state variations, you know how many hospital beds we have per capita? Well, forget per capita. If I say per 1,000 people, how much is it? 0.9. How about China? This is capacity. I'm talking about healthcare capacity now. How much does China have? Close. Think about it. This is what investment into healthcare does. There is more capacity, there is better access. So financing is important, and I want you to think of savings as one form of financing, medical savings. But access is much, much more fundamental. We have to create institutions such that rural India and the cross-state variations that we have. Why is Kerala so much more better in health outcomes than MP and UP? It needn't be. We have very similar policies. Though again, at the state level, they have been far more entrepreneurial. They've had a cultural revolution half a century back, but they're reaping the benefits of that. Why can't the rest of the country follow certain other states? We need to make investments, but beyond the investments, we need to manage our investments efficiently by designing good healthcare policy. Okay? And behavior is the third. When I spoke about Swachh Bharat, when I spoke about sanitation, everybody's building a toilet today. But that hasn't led to greater utilization of toilets. And you know why open defecation is a problem? Why? Because it contaminates, leading to all kinds of water and airborne diseases. Alright, so there's a lot of research to show that open defecation might be one of the leading causes of malnourishment, underweight and IMR in India. So we have to address these issues. Okay, but these are behavioral issues. The fact that you must use toilets, wash your hands, cut your nails, basic hygiene, drinking water, right? ORS. ORS is one of those simple innovations which is a huge success in Bangladesh. Why are we struggling with it? So when people say, oh, we are too large and we are too diverse, that is just cock and bull story. That's not true. We are very similar to Bangladesh. We were much better than Bangladesh. Today they are leaps and shoulders ahead in terms of apparel. They are leaps and shoulders ahead in terms of development indicators. Why? They went house to house, educating every mother how to create, how to make this ORS. How much water, how much salt, how much sugar. When should you give it to the child? Phenomenal success. And it's not that expensive. Why can't we do that? So we are talking about marginal. It's about using this money efficiently. As Indians, we are, you know, we have many things over inefficiencies we can quibble. But we are good at stretching our rupee. We don't throw away. We are good with using our trash. Right? That's all, again, a cultural thing we want to inculcate. Because, you know, increasing consumerism, purana jayega to naya aayega, is not necessarily a good thing. Alright, we're not so bad in using resources. Yes.
Country that people have always been saving.
Yeah.
Is it only because of laziness of the government or is it because of something else?
Don't call it laziness, call it capacity constraint. You are assuming, see, all of you think of policy as a very simple thing. Policy is also driven by individuals sitting in the government. And it's by people like you and me. We write about it, we talk about it, we make the noise at all the right forum, then it hits somebody. Of course, when you're part of a commission, yes, you do it more actively. But this is not pure science. I have said this 4 times in this room. Policy making is not fundamental pure science. It is social science. It's human behavior. It's a lot of trial and error. And you're also expecting a lot of efficiency from a bureaucracy which has zero incentive to innovate. So I would put my faith in the political leadership. I would try and incentivize the political leaders into thinking about newer mechanisms of healthcare financing.
I wanted to know whether there are any ground realities which are stopping this implementation. Like, is it not suitable for India or is it...
No, not at all. It is suitable for India. But listen guys, just because it's a good idea doesn't mean it will get implemented. That's what I'm trying to tell you. It's not always the dearth of good ideas that stops development. Implementation is perhaps more important sometimes, I'd say. So we have very many good ideas, not all of them. We have very many bad ideas we have experimented with. But what I'm saying is, just the way when I spoke about tweaking the NREGS to make it more effective and efficient, health financing is one of those things. But who's going to do it? It's like belling the cat. Public policy, I told you, government is a multi-head hydra. We should get to the ministry and, for instance, think about, I write a lot. In fact, my early, one of my op-eds in the Hindu was very damning of the government in the 10-point agenda of the Prime Minister's. And I'm mostly supportive of policies that this government has come up with. And I have advised and written and contributed to many of them. But when it comes to healthcare and gender inequality, nothing. Why? I think they're treated as ministries which are not at par with, hey, defense, finance, home, important portfolios. This is not just Delhi. You go to the district, this is what happens. You go to the state, this is what happens. Women and child development, inko shunting mein dal do. Inko women child development de do. It's not a good post. Hey, who told you it's not a good post? It's very important. We put aside a lot of public, you know, exchequer's money into that and we need good policy. There's no reason that India's, you know, gender inequality index, 124th in the world, are you kidding me? Our sex ratio, crazy, 100 million women missing. Who's going to change that? We have a ministry for that. Now your question is, do we not know what to be done? No, we know what has to be done. Not easy. We're talking about changing mindset. That's why I'm all for a selfie with a daughter, yes. I'm hugely into symbolism. Behaviors change with the symbolism. When you derive pride, Haryana sportswomen, they're doing so well. Why should Haryana have such a bad sex ratio? Right? Which is leading to all kinds of other social problems. Young men do not find brides. The brides have to be gotten from Kerala, which is a favorable sex ratio state. It's not a problem limited to India. Korea is doing the same. South Korea is getting women from Philippines and Vietnam because their sex ratio is bad too, and they are a developed country. But there is a son preference, and it's not just son preference in India. Do you know what is the one of the leading causes of gender ratio being unfavorable to women in India? If you look at the age profile of women over lifetime, 0 years to 70 years, you don't just have missing women at birth, meaning it's not feticide and infanticide. Neglect. But intentional injury. If you look at the age group of 18 to 40, many, many women are dying because of intentional injury. India is notorious for that. But in my mind, that is crime. That's just law and order. It's as much gender, but it's also law and order. Why should we tolerate this kind of stuff? So now you get my answer. It's not that simple. We have to change, but we also have to change things within the household. But we have to get things changed right from Delhi, to the state, to the districts and the villages. Yes.
For the skewed rates, skewed sex ratio, I was reading an article suggesting that along with crime rates, there are food habits responsible too. So for example, Haryana, it's a state where milk products, people consume more milk products. So that changes the pH values and the, these reports
exist. For women and men it is different.
I mean, pH values in men, since due to dependence on milk products, so...
So more men survive?
Not more, the count of the X and Y chromosomes. So yeah, these reports exist, right. Medical studies exist.
It might, so there is research and there is research. What I'm saying is, if you compare Haryana and Punjab, that X and Y chromosome you're talking about can't be so different across the border, that you have one state which has such lower sex ratio than the other. Okay, food habits are very similar between Haryana and Punjab. There are reasons. I'm not trying to discount genetics. But genetics does not explain it, is what I'm trying to tell you. Okay, it's basic neglect. I'm also telling you that it's not infanticide and feticide, meaning girls are allowed to live. That just sounds wrong, but I'll say it because it's the harsh reality. They're allowed to live. But then through the age cycle, you see that less and less women survive. Why? Nutrition. And I'm glad you said nutrition, though not the pH value nutrition. They get less to eat. They're the last people in the house who eat. Why? You should ask these questions. And most of us have seen this. Right? Girls are the last to eat. If there is something left over, if there's nothing, then the boy gets it. These are the kind of things that we have to change. They have to be allowed to go out and work. There is a lot of research to show, you know what? If you give economic opportunities to girls, and that was an experiment done in Haryana. There was an experiment, again an RCT, where they held a specialized, they held rural internet kiosk, and the kiosk only employed girls. Girls who had completed 12th standard. The minute these girls started getting jobs and getting paid for it, what did it lead to? It led to, number one, more girls remaining in the school, not dropping out. You see the symbolism of economic opportunity? You see how change happens? More girls are staying back in school to finish school. Otherwise, they usually tend to drop out after puberty. So girls are staying back, and amongst those that are staying back, they want to go for computer education. That is what, change happens in increments. So you have big public policy change, yes, crime is death of a woman because of intentional injury, that's crime. I will not put a gender perspective, that's just crime. Okay? But if you want to bring about behavioral changes, the Swachh Bharat, selfie with daughter, these are important symbolism that do go along. We don't end with symbolism. We have to do so much more. I think Menaka Gandhi has to do a lot more because her ministry has been the most laggard. They've had, every time we make noise, some amount of money is put aside. That money sits in the ministry because the ministry lacks the capacity to use that money. That's a bigger problem. So it's not, I'm glad he raised that question. Sometimes it's not just about the money. Even if we have the money, we lack the capacity in the government to use it. And this is where now I have to tell you an important, this will be my last story. I'll tell you a nice story of what happened in Delhi. You know the Delhi Metro, how many of you have used it? Yay! How many of you have used DTC buses? Okay. Have you seen the difference in the attitude? Your own attitude when you are standing for a DTC bus and your attitude when you are at the Delhi Metro. Why do you behave so differently? You do behave differently, right? DTC, we are running because if we miss it, we miss it. Metro, we are willing to wait. So this is, I'm trying to answer a question when people say, are Indians corrupt? Do Indians like to bend rules? Why are the same Indians so better and well-behaved when they go abroad? It's not cultural. I have researched, published research to show that behavior is not cultural. It has to do with availability of resources. You know why we make a line in the Delhi Metro? Because we know in so many minutes the next metro will come. Others are in line. It's just a good equilibrium and we want to perpetuate good equilibrium. We want good behavior. Because good behavior pays. If there is a stampede, we all lose. So it's a good, in game theoretic sense, what are we saying? It's a good Nash equilibrium and we will maintain it. Because one unilateral deviation will not make you better off. Everybody will look at you and say, hey, go back. That's a Nash equilibrium. In the DTC, because there is a resource crunch, it's anyway so full when it comes. I don't know when the next one will come, whether he'll stop, whether it'll come. I'm going to rush it. I want to beat the next guy. And there is no, you know, we haven't started the system of making lines there. That is how change in behavior happens. You have to make it happen by creating capacity. Create excess capacity. People are always willing to behave. And then enforce. Enforcement is a very large part of governance. People don't just behave well because they want to behave well. But bad behavior has to be punished. That's why symbolism of people, corrupt people getting punished is very high in a country like India. One of the study that we did in New York, what did it show? That these are all New York diplomats from everywhere in the world. They come from India, they come from Switzerland, Germany, Indonesia. How do they behave in New York? Because they're all governed by the same rule. So it's a good experiment. Do you understand? And one study went out and said, you know what? Indians are more corrupt because they're culturally more corrupt. There is a culture of corruption index by the World Bank, which says they are corrupt because the culture of corruption is high. Now, obviously, it's insulting to an Indian because I'm not like that. And I know most Indians are not like that. There's nothing cultural about it. People behave when there is capacity. So we took the same data, the same UN diplomats, the same World Bank index, and the World Bank also has another index. It is called Government Effectiveness Index. You know what that index explains? Government capacity. If you look at government index in government effectiveness index, that explains people's behavior far better than culture. It's not culture. It is government effective. So change can happen, but that change happens by creating the kind of capacity, enforcing the rules, and then gradually we all get towards this good equilibrium which we want to maintain. Okay? That's what evaluation does. Evaluation helps you understand where to put this marginal resource of the government, where it is most productive, not just in economic sense, but in the social sense as well. All right? Okay, guys, thank you.
Maybe.
Hi. Okay, guys, now for my pure selfish reason for being here. I do a lot of research in public policy. I've given you a short snippet of everything that I've spoken about. I have written about this stuff. Okay, these are published papers. The reason I have made this transition when I told you I'm no longer full-time with ISB is because I have now moved to a full-time research position. I only visit and teach at ISB and at Ashoka Young India Fellow. The reason I'm doing research full-time is because in India, a lot of public policy is either made in a vacuum or because you were traveling and someone told you on a flight. By the way, this is a real story. When I was, and this is not me, I'm quoting, I won't tell you who. But you know, on my return flight, somebody else sitting in the first class said, his son worked for President Obama and it's great to have a rural postdoctoral fellowship to understand rural India. So let's start a new fellowship for rural India. That's not how public money should be spent. Okay? We are doing a lot of public policy through whims, through good ideas that suddenly someone told us, through some other country experimenting. No. Public policy, because of the opportunity cost, and we are poor, we need to spend our money much, much, much more efficiently. We need data. That's what we do. That's the reason I've taken up this role. Now, the Brookings Institution is the world's oldest, largest think tank. They do research. Until now, they have been largely doing American research. Okay? We have started an independent of Washington as well, because we have our own Indian money. We have raised money in India to do Indian research. Okay? And we have Shubir Gokar, who was the deputy governor of the RBI. He is with us. We have five senior scholars. I'm one of them. And we have a group of senior research assistants and a large number of interns who are supporting us. We have a lot of non-resident affiliations as well. I welcome you, for those of you who have interest in public policy research, because we work closely not just with numbers and research, but for us communicating this idea is also very important. So we work closely with the government, with public in terms of, you know, op-eds through leading newspapers, but closely with the government and the other policy makers. So we always take a paper, hold a panel, hold several conferences, talk to ministries, get people within the ministries, beyond the political leadership, get the administrators. So communication is a large part of it. It's very thrilling for people who want to move that policy needle. You keep asking me, good ideas, why aren't they doing it? Why aren't they doing it? Because you have to do more of what we are trying to do. We need to tell people, here is a good idea. We need to do it. We need to do it. You just have to keep doing it. Those of you who have interest in this space, I want you to write to me. Okay? I have vacancies. I am looking for young, bright minds who have some technical expertise, okay, who understand numbers, they understand a little bit of statistics, but who are also keen to move that policy needle and build institutional knowledge, understand healthcare, understand financial inclusion, understand government, you know, policy making in India. Those of you interested, do write to me. My details are of course with Shobhit, but if you Google, you'll see both my pages in ISB and at Brookings. Write to me. I'll be very happy to talk.